Hello, this is Dr. Glasbrenner from George Mason University, and in this video, we will learn about statistical tools we can use to quantify and analyze our data. When we first learned how to describe the shape of data distributions, we focused on qualitative descriptions such as the center, modality, skewness, and outliers. Another important component of a distribution is its width or spread, which captures the statistical variation of a sample. Knowing how to quantify and interpret this variation is important as we begin comparing different data distributions to one another. There are different ways to measure the variation of a data distribution. One such statistical measure is called the variance. The variance is computed using the formula at the top of this slide, and can be thought of as being roughly equal to the average squared deviation from the mean. Let's consider an example to better understand what the variance is. Say you polled 217 students about the average number of hours of sleep they get each night and ended up with the distribution of responses shown on the right. The mean, or average, of this sample is 6.71 hours per night. To compute the variance, you would take a response from your sample and subtract the mean from it, square the difference, repeat this for all 217 responses, and then sum them all together. So, for example, one respondent answered 5 hours of sleep per night. We compute 5 minus 6.71, then square that. Another respondent answered 9 hours of sleep per night. So we compute 9 minus 6.71 and square that. We continue doing this until we reach the last piece of data, a response of 7 hours per night. So we compute 7 minus 6.71 and square that. We then add together all of those computations. Then, we divide that summation of values by the number of samples minus 1. This yields a variance of 4.11 hours squared, which provides a measure of the spread of the data distribution. You might wonder why we're using the squared deviation in the calculation of the variance. Here are a couple of reasons why you would want to compute the spread of the data in this particular way. First, by squaring all of the differences, we get rid of the negative signs so the observations that are equally distant from the mean are weighed equally. Frequently, we will not need to distinguish the data spread above the mean versus the spread below the mean. Second, squaring the differences means that we place more weight on larger deviations. Put another way, the variance is sensitive to outlier values. One issue with using the variance to discuss the spread of a distribution is that its units are not intuitive. In our example, how do we interpret hours squared? It's not immediately obvious. For this reason, it's much more common to use the statistical measure known as the standard deviation when discussing the spread of a data distribution. It's easy to compute once you've found the variance, as you just take its square root. This gives us a quantity that is in the same units as the data. So, for our example, the standard deviation of the amount of sleep that students get per night is 2.03 hours. If we compare this value to the histogram plotted on the right, we can see that all of the data fall within 3 standard deviations of the mean. For symmetric bell-shaped distributions like the one shown here, this is a convenient rule. Nearly all of the data will fall within 3 standard deviations either above or below the mean value. The mean, variance, and standard deviation are all connected to one another and present one method for quantifying the center and spread of a data distribution. There are other methods that are available that come with their own pros and cons. For quantifying the center, instead of the mean, you can also consider using the median. The median is the value that splits the data distribution in half after you've sorted it into ascending order. So if you have a simple sample containing the observations 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, then the median would be 2. If the number of observations in the dataset is an even number, then the median is the average of the two values in the middle. Say we included 5 in our sample. Now the median would be the average of 2 and 3, which is 2.5. Since the median is defined as the midpoint of the data, that means that 50% of values will always be below it. Hence, that means that the median is the same thing as the 50th percentile. To better understand mean and median as different types of measures for the center of a data distribution, let's consider the following examples. If you have a symmetric data distribution, the mean will usually be used as the numeric value for the center. However, as shown in this plot at the top of the slide, the mean and the median will be approximately equal to each other in a symmetric data distribution. Conversely, if the data distribution is skewed or has extreme outliers, then the median is often used to quantify the center. Consider the two example plots on the right, which compare the mean, shown as a dashed line, and the median, shown as a solid line. In a right-skewed distribution, which is the top plot on the right, the mean will be greater than the median. In a left-skewed distribution, shown in the bottom plot on the right, the mean will be less than the median. So if the median is an alternative to the mean, what statistical quantity can serve as an alternative to the standard deviation? An alternative way to think about a data distribution spread is to think about it in terms of percentiles. As we briefly mentioned when talking about the median, percentiles can be defined after we have sorted a dataset in ascending order. The 10th percentile, for example, is the value at which 10% of the data has values smaller than it and the remaining 90% of the distribution has values larger than it. Similarly, the 25th percentile, also known as the first quartile or Q1, is the value at which 25% of the data has values smaller than it and the remaining 75% of the distribution has values larger than it. The 50th percentile is the median, as we already discussed, and the 75th percentile is also known as the third quartile, or Q3. Between the first and third quartiles lies the middle 50% of the data distribution. The length spanned by the middle 50% of the data can serve as another measure of the data distribution spread, and it is called the interquartile range, or the IQR. The formula below summarizes the computation. It is the value that defines the third quartile minus the value that defines the first quartile. The median and interquartile range are both important features in a special kind of data visualization known as the box plot. Shown here is the box plot visualization for the poll of the number of hours students report sleeping each night. The box in the box plot represents the middle 50% of the data. The thick black line inside the box is the median for the data distribution. Here are the features of a box plot visualization that you should pay attention to. Since the box spans the middle 50% of the data, it shows us the locations of the first and third quartiles of a data distribution. The lines that extend out of the box are called the whiskers. The whiskers define the range of data that sit outside the interquartile range but do not constitute outliers. Data points that lie outside the reach of the whiskers are explicitly shown in the box plots and constitute suspected outliers. So, with the box plots, we have a visual method for evaluating whether or not we have possible outliers in our datasets. So, how are the lengths of the whiskers defined? The whiskers in a box plot can extend up to 1.5 times the interquartile range away from the first and third quartiles. As a formula, the maximum of the upper whisker reach is the Q3 value plus 1.5 times the IQR. The maximum of the lower whisker reach is the Q1 value minus 1.5 times the IQR. So if, for a given data set, we compute the IQR to be equal to 10, then the maximum upper whisker reach becomes 35, and the maximum lower whisker reach becomes negative 5. A potential outlier is then defined as an observation beyond the maximum reach of the whiskers. It is an observation that appears extreme relative to the rest of the data. Why is it important that we have a systematic method to look for outliers in a data distribution? By having this method, we are better equipped to identify an extreme skew in the data distribution. We can also identify instances of data collection and data entry errors that we could potentially remove or fix. It also provides insight into the interesting features of the data that should be investigated and analyzed in greater detail. Now that we have a few different statistical measures for our data distributions, how are sample statistics such as the mean, median, standard deviation, and the interquartile range affected by extreme observations in the dataset? To illustrate this, consider the following example shown in the dot plot below. The dot plot shows the distribution of a sample of annual household incomes. We could compute the mean, median, standard deviation, and IQR for this distribution. Now let's ask what would happen to the mean, median, standard deviation, and IQR if we replaced the largest value in the dataset with a value of $10 million. Similarly, what would happen to them if we instead replaced the smallest value in the dataset with a value of $10 million? Here we show the results of those calculations. For the original dataset, the median value is 190,000 and the IQR is 200,000. The mean value is 245,000 and the standard deviation is 226,000. If we move the largest data point to a value of $10 million, the median and IQR stay at their values of 190,000 and 200,000 respectively. In contrast, the mean increases to 309,000 and the standard deviation nearly quadruples to 853,000. If instead we move the smallest data point up to $10 million, the median increases slightly to 200,000, but the IQR remains at 200,000. The mean increases even further to 316,000, and the standard deviation increases to 854,000. So, in summary, we've seen that the median and the IQR are more robust to skewness and outliers, while the mean and the standard deviation are not. Therefore, if you are dealing with a skewed distribution, it is often more helpful to use the median and IQR measures to describe the center and spread. If instead you are dealing with a symmetric distribution, it is often more helpful to use the mean and standard deviation to describe the center and the spread. So, if you would like to estimate the typical household income for a student, would it be better to look at the mean income or the median income? Since, as we saw in the prior example, that incomes are a very skewed distribution, we would prefer to look at the median income. So what should we do if we are looking at extremely skewed data? When the data are extremely skewed, then applying a transformation might make interpreting and modeling them easier. A common transformation for dealing with skewed data is called the log transformation. As an example, the histogram on the bottom left shows the distribution of a number of basketball games attended by students. The histogram on the bottom right shows the same distribution after a log transformation has been applied. As you can see, we get a better idea of the variation of the data after applying the transformation. In general, skewed data are easier to model when they are transformed because outliers tend to become far less prominent after an appropriate transformation is applied. In the table below, we see what happens numerically to some of the data points in the example we considered. In the original dataset, the data points of 70 games attended, 50 games attended, and 25 games attended are quite different from one another. However, after applying a log 10 transformation, those values become 4.25, 3.91, and 3.22, respectively, which have much less variation between them. While this seemingly solves our problem, we need to be careful. The results of an analysis based on the log transformed data may be difficult to interpret because the log of a measured variable is usually meaningless.